I broke through the carbonate, that's how I got free. Jabba back off because there's no stopping me. Postmodern player, sample-tastic, flows ekphrastic. I get drastic, hey, watch the plastic. Yo, I name check and leave you drastic.
This is Spencer with The MacGuffin, and today I'm joined by, writer, director, producer, Jesse McCormick from the film Gus, which just premiered. Was it the world premiere?
World premiere.
At South by Southwest here.
Yes.
Gus, the story of two friends, one of whom is having a baby, one of whom wants a baby, and sort of all the complications that come through that process of, like, I don't know what you call it. It's not really adoption. I guess it is adoption, sort of like she wants to give it to her friend.
Right.
I don't know if there's a term for that technically.
I don't know. I mean, I guess it would be an adoption.
You can call it a Gus for now. Like,
it's make a that, Gus.
Yeah.
We're coining a new term here today.
This film, I mean, it's not like, I've seen films like Evil Dead and stuff at the festival so far. It's not violent, and yet it's still very intense. Very weird comparison, I realize. What was it like in terms of writing this film, and where did sort of the genesis of the idea come from? Because it seems like something that there's a really, I mean, I can't say you've gone through any of this stuff, but it feels like there's a very passionate story in it.
Well, I've given away a couple babies to my friends. No, I'm just kidding.
You've gussed them?
I've gussed them. The genesis was really that I wanted to depict a real female friendship in a grounded, realistic way, and show two best friends that are sort of like platonic soulmates in a way, because I feel like I'm lucky enough to have those kinds of friendships with women in my own life, and I feel like I hadn't really seen those depicted on screen so much.
Yeah.
So that was the kind of the genesis for it, and the baby stuff was really a way for me to explore that. So the friendship came first in my mind.
What was the process like of putting together the cast to do this? Because it felt like you really had to have people who had some sort of natural chemistry together. I mean, there's even like I got to give a shout out to Michael Wesson, who we've had on the podcast before.
Oh, yeah.
Who's an amazing guy. And it's so nice to see him doing, you know, a very dramatic type performance. What was it like sort of putting that
Michael
collection together?
Is a dear friend of mine. We went to high school together, so I've known him for forever, and that's how he came to be in the film. But it, you know, it was a really big leap of faith on everyone's part, because I it's not like I had a chemistry read with these ladies. You know, I just offered them the roles and sort of rolled the dice and hoped for the best, and it worked out. Their chemistry is really amazing. I think everyone's is. Very lucky. It's just instinct. You know, you feel like, I think this is going to work, so let's go for it.
Was there any sort of like opportunity for, you know, Michelle Moynihan and Rhonda Mitchell and all, really everyone, to sort of like bond before this? Or was it just like they're just such professional actresses, you just throw them out there and it's like day one, boom?
It kind of, you know, on an independent film, you don't really have time for a lot of rehearsal, but it was pretty instantaneous, the bonding. We had a lot of fun making this film, you know. We laughed a lot, and we were all very silly on set. And so we all bonded very quickly. And like I said, with Mike, for instance, I already knew him.
Uh-huh.
So I think it's always nice for on a set when if a director and an actor already know each other, it kind of, you know, the people around them kind of,
I think it would sort of shorthand the language,
like, absolutely,
you could make communication. That would be my guess, if that's what you're
That's absolutely true.
And, you know, it's funny you talk about, like, having a lot of fun on the set. And there's definitely a fair amount of comedy in the movie. I'm not going to say that. But, like, it feels like there's some scenes, particularly one at the end, which I'm not going to spoil, that seem like they would have been really tough to film. I mean, it's laughter notwithstanding. What is it like sort of balancing the drama and the comedy in the movie? Because it feels like that's a very thin, tightrope line that you have to walk, because either one way or the other, you could sort of like skew it too much more in the comedy realm, and then you're like, try to cut to the dramatic, and people can't really
right,
buy
and it
that
can be jarring.
Yeah.
Well, that to me, that was one of the toughest things about making this film, and one of the things that I looked that I made sure I kept an eye on was that thread of like, okay, here's a funny moment, then we're going into this poignant moment, and I don't want to give the audience whiplash, you know what I mean?
I totally know,
so
yeah.
I was very aware of keeping that all in check, and I think, you know, I think that's how life is, you know what I mean? I think that something funny can happen, and then a moment later, something sad happens, and that's just the way life is. So I think just being mindful of it, and like you said, not going too far in one direction, and having it be more of a fluid transition between the two tones was the goal.
And I think that's sort of one of the elements that I would find would be a challenge, and I mean, you can speak as a writing director in terms of how challenging this was the various narratives, because each character really has their own arc.
Yes.
And it seems like the potential would be there that you could have too many things going on that then you have to try and tie up at the end. It's just sort of like, everyone lives happily ever after,
right,
something like that. Was it like to try and sort of keep everyone as more than just like a two-dimensional character and yet not feel like you're overwhelming the story with too many different plot threads at the
right
same time?
Well, because we're not really following that many characters. I mean, it's really, four people stories that we're following. So I felt like that wasn't so much of an issue, because if it had been, Shortcuts where you have like a 20-person ensemble, then I think that would have been more of a challenge. I mean, it was all, it's difficult to make a movie, but it was great and fun. And I think I wanted to keep it small so that I could kind of delve into each story in more detail.
I mean, I liked the use of the dog, but you always hear
that's
like,
my dog, by the way.
Really? Wow, very well behaved.
Joyce
dog
is my dog. Thank you.
What was it like, sort of putting that element to the story? Because I mean, the dog definitely seems to have some interesting sort of representations to like a bigger issue of parenting and stuff like that, and yet it has a nice sort of part in the sort of resolution of the film. What was it like working with that into the story, as well as just working with a dog? Because you hear that's the thing is like,
I know,
never
no
do animals
kids and dog. I know.
Which
I know. I know. Well, the dog for me really helped illustrate Lizzie's plight in the film, and it was a way for me to show her the longing she had for a child. I could show that with the dog without having to say anything. And anytime you can anytime you can use an image rather than have someone talk about it in a film, I think is the way to go. You know what I mean? You don't want a whole lot of exposition in your film. And so it was a way for me to show the audience, like, this is what's going on with her, and we see what's going on with her through her relationship with her dog.
How tightly scripted was everything throughout the movie? Because I would think it would be a very pre-scripted kind of project, but then you have someone like Michael Weston, who is a very talented improviser, so it's sort of like I could see like the ping pong scene with him and Michelle Moynihan. Like,
right,
it felt like something like that very well could have been just improvised.
It was definitely very scripted. There was some improv in the movie, but it was by and large what you saw was written. But there were a couple moments in the ping pong scene, for example, that were improvised.
It felt very natural. Yeah.
With that particular scene, we actually kind of combined some of the written lines with some of the improv in the editing process. Yeah, which is not always, you can't always do that. It doesn't always cut together.
Yeah.
But in that instance, it did. So
one of the things I also want to talk about is just looking at your background. You have an acting background.
Yeah.
How did that sort of influence you becoming a director and the stuff, A, that you want to direct, and B, how you work with actors since you've had
it,
that background?
It absolutely informed how I direct and how I write. I mean, I started writing this is my first feature as a director, but I've been writing for a long time now. And being an actor completely informed how I write, because I try to write lines. Are these lines I'm writing literally utterable? Will they fit in someone's mouth? Can you actually say them? And I actually say every line of every script I write out loud. I play all the parts. I say them out loud just to see, is this an utterable line of dialogue I'm writing? And, you know, when it came to directing, because I had been an actor, I feel like that helps me communicate with actors and maybe give them direction that will help them, because I've been in their shoes and I have great empathy for them. And I think, you know, a lot of directors, when I was an actor, I would work with directors, and you hear this all the time, and they don't really know how to talk to actors. It's a real shame, because having had that experience, you know, having acted in the past has just informed the way I do, you know, everything now, you know.
Does that lead you to, say, give the actors more latitude in terms of starting to find their characters? I don't know. I mean, it seems like, I've never acted. Well, I haven't acted since some, like, eighth grade play or something like that. And even that was really just, like, satirical at best. But it's sort of like, do you try and let them find who these characters are, or do you try and outline who you see these characters are? Because it seems like, I mean, these are all very professional actors you're dealing with. It seems like they have their own sort of interests when they come into this movie. Like, I don't know, did you just give them a script and they read it and they sort of generate in their minds who these characters are? Or did you just say, like, this is who your character is, and then they read the script?
No, I didn't want to do that. I wanted to give them the freedom to, you know, bring their own stuff to it. And you know, I sort when direction was called for, I gave it, but I didn't want to, you know, dictate every move they made. That's no fun for an actor, and it stifles their creativity, and they're going to bring great stuff to the table that, you know, didn't even occur to me. So it's definitely a collaboration.
And this is a pretty big film right out the gate for a first feature. Was there any nerves in terms of doing that? Were you ever thinking about, you know, acting in the film yourself because you might understand the characters?
I had made a short that I wrote, directed, and acted in, and I knew that I did not want to act in the feature. There was just no way. It's just too much for me, at least. And I'm really happy staying behind the scenes. Sure. But I think there was definitely nervous anticipation. You know, at the initial stages. Well, let me back up and say I waited a long time to direct a film,
right,
because I was sort of mustering up the confidence to do it. It's something I've been wanting to do for a long time. So once I decided this is happening, it wasn't that nerve-wracking, actually. The anticipation of it was a little bit, but once I was, you know, in the throes of it, the nerves kind of went away, and I just felt really excited and happy to be doing it. You know, this is my dream. So
in terms of, like, your career in general, is this a shift? Like, are you wanting to do directing primarily, or do you still have the interest in acting?
I don't so much in acting. That's not to say I'll never do it again. If someone approaches me about something,
Inception,
if Scorsese calls, you know, I'll do dinner with him. But it's not a career that I'm pursuing in any way, and I don't have any, like, secret ache inside to be acting. I'm really happy writing and directing, and that's what I want to be doing.
And, I mean, obviously this is a film existing in the indie world. What is sort of the experience like in terms of releasing? What is the plan for release? When can people see it? I mean, I'm sure that's, you know, directing your first feature is a big challenge. Then getting your first feature distributed is a challenge, and so on and so forth.
Well, that's sort of the next step. That's the path we're now navigating with our sales agent. And so it's unclear at this moment what path the film will take, but we're positive.
It'll be after a good first screening, you know, that always sets a good
thank tempo. Thank you.
In terms of, you know, going forward with the film? Where can people keep tabs on, you know, where it'll play, other festivals, when it gets released?
Well, we have a website.
Oh, there we go. What's the website?
Called GusMovie.com. Mm. And that will have information about, you know, festivals and where you can see it and all that stuff.
Fantastic. And
yes.
In terms of you, is there any place people can keep up to date with what you're doing, what you might have coming up?
You know, that information will be on the website
okay.
as well. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Perfect. Awesome. Well, thank you so much
thank
for this.
You.
I wish you luck with the distribution of the film, and you can find more interviews at MacGuffinPodcast.com.
Thank you.
Can't stop me, I'm on fire tonight. Even Zod can't stop me, I'm on fire tonight. It's tight, don't even try to buy the size of that. Mr. Spock can't stop me, I'm on fire tonight. The Wrath of Khan can't stop me, I'm on fire tonight. The board can't stop me, because I've got space game and it feels all